Morning, CBC. So glad you're with us today. We are really excited to worship with you today. If you have been getting the Vine, you've seen all the announcements that we've got pretty much in there. We're expectantly hopeful tomorrow as the governor will deliver us some more information about how Open Texas is going. And as a leadership, we continue to pray through the process and how we're going to eventually resume gathering, what that'll be like for us. For now, here we are live streaming with you, and so glad that you're with us today. Our call to worship is in Psalm 40, verses 16 and 17. But may all who seek you rejoice and be glad in you. May those who love your salvation say continually, "Great is the Lord." As for me, I am poor and needy, but the Lord takes thought for me. You are my help and my deliverer. Do not delay, O my God. Let's pray together. Father, as we gather together this way today, we give you honor and thanks and praise for allowing us to do this. God, I thank you for those who have gathered with us wherever they might be. And I pray that through your word and through your prayers of your people, the songs of your people, the gifts of your people, God, I pray that we would be strengthened and encouraged, that you would impart to your people grace today. God, we recognize that you, O Lord, are our help. Help for the poor and the needy. We approach you that way today. You are our deliverer, O God. And so we have come to you, expecting you, Father, to impart great things to your people today. What great blessings you've given us by your word. What an opportunity it is to be with your people this Lord's Day morning. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
How I love your works, my God, my King. How I love your works, my God, my King. Your name rings on the plains like a not-so-distant train. Love and history are in the flowers that you made, the flowers that you made.
But the blood of Jesus.
Well, today is normally the day that we would bring our seniors up, our high school seniors, and recognize them for the day. Obviously, things are a little bit different. Things are real different for the seniors this year. But we wanted to still take a chance to highlight them for you, to give them the great resources that you as a church always gift to them. And so we went around this week to their houses to hear from those seniors, hear what they're doing next, and we want to let you hear those things. And then we're going to do just like we always do. We're going to pray together for those seniors. So check out this quick video that we made of our seniors, and we'll pray together after that. We're here at Tressa Clark's house in Scurry. Tressa is a senior at Crandall High School, and we wanted to know what's happening with Tressa moving forward.
I'll be going to San Jose State University in Huntsville, Texas to major in forensic science and minor in criminal justice.
That's great. Well, we've got some excellent materials for you, ESV Study Bible, some great study materials. We're so proud of you. We're praying for you and excited where you're going next. We are in Kaufman at Chloe Wright's house. Chloe is a senior at Kaufman High School. She's going to tell us a little bit about what's happening for her moving forward.
After high school, I plan on attending KCC and studying animal science.
That's great, Chloe. Well, we have a ESV study Bible for you, an excellent resource and other study materials. And we're just so proud of you. We're so excited for you moving forward and praying for you and excited where the Lord's going to lead you. We're here in Scurry at Chris Clark's house. Chris is a senior at Crandall High School. Chris is going to tell us a little bit about what he's going to do moving forward.
I plan to go to A&M at Commerce to major in mathematics, and then eventually I plan to get my teacher certification.
That's fantastic. Well, great. Well, we've got an ESV study Bible for you, some great materials that we're excited for you to have. We love you. So proud of you. Praying for you moving forward, Chris.
Thank you.
We're in Kaufman at Kyla West's house. Kyla is a senior at Kaufman High School. She's going to tell us a little bit about what's going on for her moving forward.
Yeah, I'll be attending East Texas Baptist University, where I'll be studying psychology and playing basketball.
That's great. Well, we've got an ESV study Bible for you, excellent resource materials as well that you're going to really enjoy. We're proud of you. We're praying for you. Excited to see where the Lord takes you, Kyla. Awesome. A great group. And you have seen them grow up right before your eyes here at CBC. You've been part of discipling them, mentoring them in the faith, and partnering with their families for the gospel. And so do be sure and reach out to them during this kind of senior graduating season and the things that they're doing. Give them your encouragement and send them off well. Got some great things in store for them. We're going to pray together that the Lord would use them where they go. So let's stop and let's pray together as a church for those seniors. Father, we do just lift them up before you. We thank you for those gifts, the children. They were once children and now have grown up into young men and women. For Kyla and Tressa, for Chloe and Chris, we give you thanks. Great praise, God, that you have raised them up here at CBC to know you, to love you. We pray that they would go on and they would serve you in all their different capacities. God, help them to shine brightly as lights in dark places all over. Thank you for the way that you send parts of our people out, just parts of our church family out to be in new locations, new places, Father, and to reach new people. We pray these things for them, O God, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give each of them a spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him, having the eyes of their hearts enlightened, that they might know what is the hope to which he has called them. God, that they would know what are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power toward those who believe, according to the working of his great might. Father, would you help those truths that they have been raised in to seep so deeply down into them, they would be ingrained in their hearts and minds, that they could not help but each day to walk in those things. Protect them, guide them, God. Keep them safe as they go to these different places. May their minds be strengthened, may their faith be strengthened and not swayed. God, we're so grateful, God, that you have raised them up in this way, and we pray that you will continue to do a great work in them. Complete that work, as you have said to the Philippians, that you will complete that work. We pray toward your completion of their sanctification. God, we're excited to see all the places that you would take them, O Lord. Guide and direct them, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, CBC. I want to enter into a time of prayer right now. There's a lot of things that you've seen on the vine, and different things. I want to highlight a couple of the a few of those things. But first of all, I want to give an update on Horace. Horace is one of our missionaries that we support with Wycliffe Associates and Bible Translators. There's a couple of things he wanted us to share. Number one, you know, they are building a house. Horace and Lana are building a house right now, and it's slow going. And so they said, they've decided just to, because of rain and mud and obviously the virus, things have been real slow. So they said they've just decided to take it as it comes so they won't stress out. And if you've ever built a house, you know that they say, hey, it's going to take 1 week to build your house. And it doesn't. It takes longer than that. So they've just decided, instead of stressing out, they're just going to take it. So just pray for Horace and Lana as they are waiting on the work of their house. Also, as far as Wycliffe Associate goes, Horace's work has slowed down quite a bit. But the office in Orlando, the headquarters in Orlando, will reopen tomorrow with about 25% of its personnel. So please pray for them as they transition into opening up that slowly. They're going to do that tomorrow. Also, there are some national translators that not only are continuing to translate God's word, but are actually increasing that right now. So some of the translators are doing really well. So please pray for Wycliffe Associates. Pray for Horace and Lana as they continue to work with them. Also, just some things that you saw in the vine I want to highlight. Jerry Eskridge. As you know, he has lung cancer. He's going to be undergoing radiation 5 days a week and chemo every week for the next 6 weeks. So please just continue to pray for Jerry. I think he just completed his first round of radiation this last week. So please pray for Jerry and Marchez as they do that. Also, James Kraft had eye surgery recently and it went well, but there's a few complications. So just please pray for James as he continues to recover from that. Also, Abe Phillips, who is Matt and Melanie Phillips' son, he broke his neck, the C1 vertebrae, and he's in a neck brace. So just please pray for that family. Pray for Abe as he learns how to live with this neck brace for several weeks. Just pray for that family. Also, this Thursday, Michelle Williams is having back surgery. So pray for her as she's having back surgery this Thursday. Also, I talked with Moises Mora this week, and he and Lucy are in quarantine right now, a 14-day quarantine, because Lucy's co-worker's husband was tested positive for the virus. So Lucy and Moises have to be in quarantine for 14 days. So please pray for them as they quarantine. You guys also saw that this week Caleb Hochstetler passed away. This is the 10-year-old son of Delton, who's been struggling with leukemia. I wanted to show you guys this picture. Matt, can you see if they can see this picture here? Is that about right? This is the Hochstetler family. That's Delton and his wife, Fernie, and then their five children. We've been praying for Caleb and we've been praying for this family. Delton, you know, it's hard to understand. Delton was raised in Canada. He leaves Canada. He has a life in Sao Paulo, Brazil, building an orphanage for children. It's hard to understand this. Many of us have been praying for Caleb for a long time now. And it's important to remember what we learn about God in God's word during these times. I don't know why, you know, God didn't choose to heal Caleb. That's up to God. But there's two things I do know. One, God's ways are higher than our ways. God's thoughts are higher than our thoughts. And many of us have been praying that God would heal him, have been joining with his family, and God chose not to do that. But his ways are higher. We have to remember that. And number two, we know that God's word says that God is good all of the time. And death is not good, and disease is not good. That is a result of the fall. That's a result of sin. But God's choice to not heal Caleb, for whatever reason, God's choice was good. We can rest in that. Please pray for the family. Delton and Fernanda are the parents. Naomi, Joshua, Priscilla, and Lucas. Caleb was 10 years old. So as we take a minute, I just want you, the scripture teaches us that the faithful, fervent prayer of a righteous person avails a lot. And so of these things, I want you to pick two things to pray for right now. So there's Jerry with his lung cancer and his treatments, James Kraft with his recovering from his eye surgery, Abe Phillips learning how to deal with the neck brace, Michelle Williams on her back surgery on Thursday, Moises and Lucy quarantining, and the Hochstetler family. If you would, just pick two of those things for the next minute or so and just pray for them, remembering that God's ways are higher than our ways, and every single thing God has ever done, God does, and God ever will do are good. Every single thing that He does is good. So let's pray. Well, God, today we remind ourselves of the things that we know that are true. And God, that every single thing you do is good. Everything. Even the things that we would interpret are not good. God, we know that everything you do is good. We know death is not good. But we know that you are good. We know that Christ has conquered sin and death. We know that, God, you are greater than disease. You are greater than injury. God, you are above all. And God, we say again because we remind ourselves, God, your ways are higher than our ways. Your thoughts are higher than our thoughts. And so, God, please take our confusion and the times that we don't understand why you do some of the things you do, God. Take that confusion and that lack of understanding, God, and remind us of truth. God, may we rest in your sovereignty. May we rest in your goodness. May we rest in your steadfast love. And as we join even now with the Hochstetler family, Delton and Fernanda and all of their children. Oh God, we pray, we know that you are with them, and we pray, God, that you would just continue to give them peace. I know that they believe you, I know they trust you, I know that they are on board with your sovereignty. So God, I just pray that you would continue to give them peace, continue to comfort them during this time. God, let them know that there are believers that have never even met them, that are praying for them, that are loving them, that are mourning with them all over the world. God, we pray for Michelle as she has her surgery on Thursday. We pray for James Kraft as he continues to heal from his eye surgery. We pray for Abe as he continues to deal with his neck break. God, we pray all of these things in his blessed and holy name. The Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. God, we pray these things in His name. Amen. Thank you.
on his throne. Come, let us adore him. Behold our King. Nothing can compare. Come, let us adore
Thanks for bearing with us. Those of you who are able to make it back on, I know a few of you are probably still working on finding the new feed, so thank you for those who have already found it. And if you notice that someone hasn't been able to hop back on the feed, please just maybe shoot them a text or give them a call real quick and help them find that new feed. And thank you again for your patience with us. And sometimes we have internet issues, that is true. Also, just want to give you a quick reminder about different ways you can give your offerings. You can bring an offering by the church office, you can send it through the mail, or you can go to our website and click that give button on the very top for that. So we thank you for faithfully giving and just wanted to remind you to do that as you have opportunity and the Lord blesses you. We're in Philippians chapter 2 today, and you can open your Bibles if you haven't already. to verse 19. That's where we'll begin. I hope in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you soon, so that I too may be cheered by news of you. For I have no one like him who will be genuinely concerned for your welfare. For they all seek their own interests, not those of Jesus Christ. But you know Timothy's proven worth, how as a son with a father he has served with me in the gospel. I hope therefore to send him just as soon as I see how it will go with me. And I trust in the Lord that shortly I myself will come also. I have thought it necessary to send to you Epaphroditus, my brother and fellow worker and fellow soldier, and your messenger and minister to my need. For he has been longing for you all and has been distressed because you heard that he was ill. Indeed, he was ill, near to death. But God had mercy on him, and not only on him, but on me also, lest I should have sorrow upon sorrow. I am the more eager to send him, therefore, that you may rejoice at seeing him again, and that I may be less anxious. So receive him in the Lord with all joy, and honor such men, for he nearly died for the work of Christ, risking his life to complete what was lacking in your service to me. The New York Times puts out a learning blog that they share with different schools who can have their students comment on these blogs, and it's part of their learning process. And they wrote a piece recently about our fascination with superheroes. And they asked junior high and high school students which superpower they would want if they could have one. And the students would leave their comments on this blog piece letting them know, okay, yeah, this is the one I want. Here are a few examples. Aspen wrote this: I wish that I could fly, but I guarantee that if I were the first person to be able to fly, I would not share my power with anyone, because then everyone would be trying to fly and crowd up the sky, and then all the birds would get angry, and that would just not be a good thing. Daniel commented, my superpower would be teleportation. The superpower my mom would most likely be is being a super smart scientist, because she is dumber than my friend Dale. I don't know. Now, he puts these things together, don't worry. If she had that power, I would let her do my homework every night. I would fight crime with my power and be the criminal as well. I mean, since you have the power where no one can catch you, then why not rob a bank or two or several? And then there's Jason. His comment: I honestly have no idea what superpower I would have if I could have one. I'm required to comment on one of these blogs every school morning, and this one just ain't happening. Kind of feel like Jason. But do you ever wish you had a superpower sometimes? You probably already know how you would answer the question. You've thought about this one before in a small group setting or something. Which superpower would you have? But would your answer change if your superpower related to circumstances when others were in your life were hurting or they were struggling? If it wasn't all about what you got out of your superpower, but what someone else maybe needed from you? When situations are difficult or people are struggling, we sometimes feel like we need to be other people's superheroes. But it's really a lot simpler than that. Simpler. They have a superhero already. In Jesus. There are limits to what you can do for others in their difficult times. You're a human. You're not a superhuman. But in God's designs, the things you can do are absolutely very important things. And that's what we see today. Who should you be when people are hurting? Maybe they're grieving a death. They're going through a divorce or enduring a job loss. Maybe some people are hurting in very distinct ways right now in these kind of situations when it comes to anxiety and things that we're facing. Are you supposed to be their superhero? What ought you to do for someone when they're in a really tough circumstance? You've seen people right now and you're thinking, gosh, maybe their child is abandoning the church. Maybe their nest is empty for the first time in 25 years. Maybe they're unmarried, but they really want to be married. They're struggling with it. Does it take a superpower to come to people's aid? In this part of his letter to the Philippians, Paul put a couple guys forward as examples of exactly who he and the hurting Philippians needed during their time of struggle. And there was nothing overly heroic about what these guys did. And there's nothing overly heroic about what God asks you to do for others either. During a hard time for the Philippians, Paul, Timothy, and Epaphroditus, they did three very simple unheroic, not the least bit super things. One, they showed concern for the ones hurting. Two, they served the needs of the ones hurting. And three, they encouraged the ones hurting. That's what we're going to look at today. It's really as simple as that for you too. There's no flight or teleportation or super smart scientistness needed. No superheroes needed. Context. The first guy, well, not the first guy, but one of the guys, the one we're going to look at first that Paul mentions in this letter is Epaphroditus. Epaphroditus. The Philippians had sent this guy, Epaphroditus, to Paul to help with his need. If you look over, if you have, in your Bible, you turn over to chapter 4, and you can look at verse 18. And Paul is talking there about having his needs supplied, talking to the Philippians. What does he say? I have received full payment and more. I am well supplied, having received from Epaphroditus the gifts that you sent, Philippians, a fragrant offering, a sacrifice acceptable and pleasing to God. So Epaphroditus was a Philippian friend, right? That they sent to Paul to provide for some of Paul's needs in prison. Now, Paul, in this letter that he's sending, is sending Epaphroditus back to the Philippians. So back to chapter 2, verse 25. I've thought it necessary to send to you Epaphroditus, my brother and fellow worker and fellow soldier. And so Epaphroditus is actually going to be accompanying this letter that Paul is writing from prison to Philippi, taking it to the church at the Philippians. Then the other guy that Paul mentions, you've heard of very often throughout Scripture. His name is Timothy. Timothy had been with Paul in many places on different journeys, missionarying. The Philippians were well aware of Timothy. They loved Timothy. And he would have been a great substitute for Paul to send in his absence. Paul's stuck in prison. Who does he send? He's thinking Timothy's probably the right man for the job. Verse 19. I hope in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you soon, so that you too may be cheered by news. Then down to verse 23. I hope therefore to send him just as soon as I will see, as I see how it will go with me. So Paul was waiting for the right time to send Timothy to the Philippians. And then Paul himself wants to get to the Philippians too. Verse 24. I trust in the Lord that shortly I myself will come also. So this is a really cool look here in these 12 verses that we're looking at early church relationships. What was it like for members of the early church? And how did they talk to each other? How did they relate to missionaries? It's really neat. And it's a really good reminder that these were normal people. These are not supers. You know, they're not like the Incredibles hiding their super suits in their closets. These are normal people, ordinary disciple makers. What was so great about Timothy and Epaphroditus that Paul would spend a pretty good chunk of a pretty short letter talking about how important it was that they be sent to the Philippians? You're kind of thinking, this feels kind of out of place maybe, but it's obviously very important that Paul talk to the Philippians about this. Why? It wasn't about their superpowers. During a difficult time for the Philippians, which we have established that it was, we've said that again and again, week after week, how hard this time was for them of separation from Paul, persecution from the church, difficult time for Paul being in prison. These were struggling saints. They were hurting. They're in a tough circumstance. What could mere unsuper people offer them in their hurting? Did they need to transform into Paul's superheroes in order to help him? Did they need to transform into the Philippians' superheroes? Is that who they needed to be for them? No. There was nothing overly heroic about what they did for these hurting saints. It was much simpler than that. During others' hard times, when you're thinking, what can I possibly do for them? I want to reach out. You know, you're thinking, I want to reach out to them, but I just don't know how. I'm so ordinary. I have so little gifting. I'm not charismatic. I don't have that kind of personality. Don't try to be super. Jesus is their superhero. There are three things anyone can do from this passage, and these are not super. Three things anyone can do to aid the struggling. And the first one is, don't try to be super. Just show concern. Just show concern. At the most basic level, when people are going through a hard time, they simply need to know that you're concerned about them. During this hard time for the Philippians, Timothy, Epaphroditus and Paul all show genuine concern for the Philippians, right? There's nothing super heroic about that, just concern. First, Paul knew that Timothy would show concern for the Philippians when he was near them. Go to verse 20. "For I have no one like him," Paul is talking about Timothy, "who will be genuinely concerned for your welfare, Philippians." Paul's saying, if I send him, I know that he'll care. I know he won't turn a blind eye to your suffering. I'm going to coach T-ball. All my kids coached in T-ball. And you always had to know which ones you were going to put in the right place in the order because you knew which ones would hit a home run. Paul very similarly knows, this is my guy. If I offer him up to some people to show concern, he's going to hit a home run with this one. And that word, no one, in verse 20, that phrase, that's one word in the Greek sentence, and it's the very first one. Okay? No one I have like him. It's emphasis on how Timothy excels in this area of concern. He was genuinely concerned. That's a big word. And it's meant to be a little bit of a stab. It's implying that there were others whose concern wasn't so genuine. We've already seen in Philippians chapter 1 that there were others who were preaching the gospel from impure motives. Same kind of thing here. That was Timothy, but also Epaphroditus was already showing concern for the Philippians. Look at verse 26. "For he," that's Epaphroditus, "has been longing for you all and has been distressed because you heard that he was ill." So at some point, we don't exactly know when in the timeline of this letter delivery and prison and back and forth, at some point Epaphroditus had gotten sick. Either on the journey to get to Paul when the Philippians sent him, he's journeying across the sea, whatever it might be, he gets sick, maybe. Or maybe he had already gotten there, he was caring for Paul in prison as he would go back and forth, conditions weren't great, maybe he gets sick then. At some point he got sick. The Philippians had been notified, hey, your buddy Epaphroditus has gotten ill, like really, really ill. And apparently, when Paul is writing this letter to the Philippians, they don't know yet that he has recovered. There were probably months in between letter deliveries when people sent these letters to a church or to a person, right? Our emails sometimes sit in cyberspace for minutes or hours, and we're like, how long is this going to take? But it took them months just to get a letter. Somewhere, if you want to read an excellent book about just kind of the conception of what that might have been like, there's a book called The Lost Letters of Pergamum. It's by Bruce Longenecker. It's an excellent, excellent, easy to read, short book. I highly recommend it. It gives you a look at how letter sending back and forth that we have might have been like. But it was a long time, and so the Philippians didn't know that Epaphroditus was better yet. But for Epaphroditus, in the meantime, there was longing, he says. There was distress over the Philippian state. That's very strong language of concern. And Epaphroditus is this way, this longing and this distress, he's this way about the Philippians when he is the one who's sick or has been sick, right? That's just utter selflessness in his concern. So Timothy and Epaphroditus, and then Paul himself showed concern throughout the writing of this letter. At every point, his purpose in addressing the Philippians is to set their minds at ease about something, right? About his situation, right? Being okay with whatever the outcome might be for his situation in prison. About the persecutors of the church, he's writing them. They're not going to have the last laugh, Philippians, don't worry. He's concerned for them, and he shows it just word after word after word. Timothy, Epaphroditus, Paul showed concern for the Philippians in great contrast to those who didn't show concern. Look at verse 21. After Paul says, I've got no one like him, like Timothy, who will show concern for you, he says, "For they all seek their own interests, not those of Jesus Christ." Now, that is a terrifying indictment of a verse. Paul's talking about the others who are around him, maybe the ones that we looked at in chapter 1 that had impure motives. Calvin writes this about them. John Calvin says, "They were so warm in pursuing their own interests that they were cold in the work of the Lord." It's like all the heat and the passion they could have had for the work of God was transferred away to what they wanted it to be on. You know when you put a fire in your fireplace, if you go right up to the fire and you face it, you know, all that heat is right there on your front, but your back is cold. It's the same kind of thing. They were facing the wrong way, facing the wrong fire. All the interest is one way, and so they were cold to the work of the Lord. And the work of the Lord in this case was very simply caring for the struggling people of God. They had no care, no concern. During others' hard times, don't try to be super. Just show concern. Do people know that you're concerned about them when they go through something difficult? They know it. Would your church leadership call on you to show compassionate concern to others? They just know, if I send her, yes, I know she'll care. I know she won't turn a blind eye to suffering. She'll follow up. She'll be there with concern. You should show it genuinely, as Timothy did. Mean it. Mean it when you say to somebody, I'll pray for you. Or don't say it. Don't say it. People can sniff out false concern. They can. Show it like Epaphroditus did, with longing and distress. There is an element of feeling concern deep in your bones. That word that he's used a couple times already, splachnoi, right? Guts, we might say. There's a fire in your belly for people. There is a selflessness that this kind of longing for someone requires that you may need to develop first in you before you have any shot at showing concern. If you're not showing concern for the hurting, it's probably because you're self-centered. It's like you've got tunnel vision goggles on that don't actually look forward. They actually spin back around and they only look at yourself. And that keeps you from seeing the hurting of others, the struggling of others, and thus showing concern. Pray that you might develop genuine concern for those who are struggling. Let them know about it. This, showing concern, as simple as it is the work of the Lord, as Calvin put it, right? It's simple, it's not heroic, but it's caring for the struggling people of God. Are you so warm in pursuing your own interests that you are cold to this work of the Lord? Like all the heat and passion you could have for this very thing is transferred away from where it ought to be, facing the wrong fire. Don't try to be super. Just show concern. Just show concern. Don't try to be super. Second, just serve needs. Serve needs. When people are going through a hard time, they usually have some very just basic things that you can help them with. Right? This is a hard time for the Philippians. And during that time, Paul, Timothy, Epaphroditus, they served the Philippians' needs. Nothing super heroic, just meeting needs. Timothy, first of all, had been serving Paul. Verse 22. Look what Paul says about Timothy. You know Timothy's proven worth, how as a son with a father, he has served with me in the gospel. So Timothy has been serving the gospel. In the gospel means in the work of the gospel, the ministry of the gospel, the advancing of the gospel. Timothy was advancing, serving the needs of the mission. Don't you think that served Paul emotionally? Don't you think that it served him spiritually? Don't you get so fired up when someone else shows interest in something that you love? That thing that you talk about all the time? They finally are like, they're on board with it. And they're all in with it. People are finally starting to realize how great fanny packs are, for instance. I've been trying to tell everyone for a long time. And so now when you get behind that with me, I'm going to get fired up. Same kind of thing. With me, he says. Timothy isn't Paul's servant. That's important. He's a servant of Christ. Servant of the gospel. Serving with Paul. But in serving the gospel, Timothy was serving right alongside Paul, he says, like a son. My son Camp is beginning to learn more and more about doing yard work, mowing and edging and weed eating and all that kind of stuff. It's neat when your child begins to work with you on those things, serving alongside you. And there's an element there of them serving your needs in that. It's the same thing for Timothy. He's not Paul's servant, but in serving alongside him, there's an element that Timothy is serving Paul's needs too. Paul couldn't do all this stuff alone. He needed some off of his plate, off of his shoulders. Timothy was serving Epaphroditus, second, had been serving Paul, been serving the Philippians, been serving the gospel by meeting needs. Right? He served the gospel in verse 25. I have thought it necessary to send to you Epaphroditus, my brother and fellow worker and fellow soldier. Right? When Paul says brother, he's not talking about like, oh, brotherhood. He's talking more about how he's a close ministry partner, a gospel associate, right? Paul calls him then a worker, right? Epaphroditus. So apparently serving does take a little work. Physical work, maybe. Mental work, almost definitely. Paul calls Epaphroditus a soldier. So serving these probably isn't always super easy. It might be simple. That doesn't make it easy. There are obstacles in the way of your service to people and service to the gospel. There's an enemy who doesn't want you to reach out to anybody. Epaphroditus served the gospel. He served Paul and the Philippians. Look at the rest of verse 25. Who else is he? He's your messenger, Philippians, and he's minister to my need, says Paul. So he served both Paul and the Philippians as messenger, right? That's serving their basic need for communication. How's Paul in prison going to communicate with the Philippians across a sea? Someone's got to meet that need, be that go-between. They have a need to hear from each other. And Epaphroditus sets to meeting that. Silence is golden, but not forever. As a minister to Paul's needs, he is serving, right? Whatever Paul might have needed in prison, it appears that Epaphroditus was the one to bring in the basics. Maybe more parchments, maybe more books or pens that to write with, quills, maybe some peanut butter. I don't know. And Epaphroditus, serving these needs, had nearly died doing so. Verse 30. He nearly died for the work of Christ, risking his life to complete what was lacking in your service to me, Philippians. When Paul's talking about them lacking in service, he's not saying y'all have done a terrible job. No, the Philippians had wanted to send Paul gifts, but they'd been unable to. Look over at chapter 4. Look at verse 10 in chapter 4. Paul says, I rejoice in the Lord greatly that now at length you have revived your concern for me, Philippians. You were indeed concerned for me, but you had no opportunity, meaning you had no way to meet my needs where you were sitting. I know you wanted to. Go down to verse 18 again. And he's saying, ha, now I've received full payment and more. I'm well supplied, having received from Epaphroditus the gifts that you sent. So Epaphroditus was the Philippians' way of actually meeting Paul's needs too. There's a connection there. And in doing so, while he was doing this, Epaphroditus, Paul says, came near to the point of death. That's what it literally says in verse 30. ESV translates it here, he nearly died for the work of Christ, but literally says came near to the point of death. Does that have an echo to it? Does that sound familiar, that phrase, to the point of death? If you remember just a couple of weeks ago, in verse 8 of chapter 2, let's look back there when Paul is telling us that beautiful hymn about Jesus Christ. It says, in being found in human form, Jesus humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death. This is the very same phrase that Paul now uses for Epaphroditus, mechri thanatou. Epaphroditus risked his own health to serve Paul. In the same way that you probably see certain people right now risking their own health to serve others. Simple. And then Paul had also been serving the Philippians' needs as well. He was hitting at every spiritual and emotional need that he could in this letter, trying to fill up their spiritual needs, their emotional needs. He sends Timothy. He sends Epaphroditus. That's an effort to do what? To meet the Philippians' spiritual and emotional needs. He himself says, I want to get to you. Why? To meet some spiritual and emotional needs. Even the Philippians, he says in verse 30, had tried to meet needs. During others' hard times, don't try to be super. Just serve needs. Serve the ones who are hurting. There are some things that they can't do themselves during certain circumstances. Find out what those things are. Play detective a little bit. Look around. That's when it takes work, right? Physical work, probably. Mental work, almost definitely. Looking around. Okay, where's the need? It might not be easy, like it wasn't necessarily for Epaphroditus, right? There are obstacles to this. There's an enemy who wants to prevent you from doing it. But the needs of those who are hurting are probably almost always just very basic. Grocery runs or childcare or someone just to sit with, someone to listen to them, someone to just be their companion for a little bit, just hearing from somebody. Serve what they need, not necessarily what you want to give them. Doesn't mean you have to ask them all the time. Some people, when they're hurting, don't want you to go up and say, "What exactly can I do for you?" That is not always a helpful thing, but you can take the time to figure it out. You might even need to risk your own health, your own life, to do this at certain times. Also, serving needs. Think about what Timothy and Epaphroditus did. They kept on serving the gospel mission. Right? You do the same. Keep on serving our gospel mission, our vision, our important calling. Why? Because that gives encouragement to those who are struggling, right? Assuming that they're partners with us in this mission to make disciple-making disciples, they're going to say, "Wow, oh wow, they're getting fired up about this thing that I love. I'm not quite in it as much as I usually am right now, but they are fired up and so am I now." That's encouraging. Get excited about fanny packs. These guys didn't put the gospel ministry on hold as they serve people's needs. They did those things in tandem, right? Indeed, the service of people's needs, that's part of our discipleship. Those two things go hand in hand. Don't try to be super. Just serve needs. Just show concern. Just share joy. Number three. Don't try to be super, just share joy. When people are going through a hard time, they're often struggling, right? They're often struggling to do what? To fight for joy. To fight for joy. And during this difficult time for the Philippians, Paul and Timothy and Epaphroditus, they all encouraged the Philippians. That was just a basic, simple, not so heroic thing that they needed. Encouragement. Paul predicted that Epaphroditus would bring joy to the Philippians once he got to them, right? Verse 28. Paul says, I am the more eager to send Epaphroditus, therefore. Why? That you may rejoice at seeing him again, and that I may be less anxious. So, Philippians, receive him in the Lord with what? All joy. It's like Paul has got out his crystal ball and he's looking in and he's saying, if I send Epaphroditus, oh my goodness, their faces are going to light up. It's that word all again, all joy, receiving with all joy, pas, panta, right? All. It's big, it's bursting. And we have to assume that this prediction came true. Epaphroditus got to the Philippians and they were pumped about it. A key purpose in Epaphroditus journeying to this church was simply to share joy. That's it. And the Philippians' joy would even relieve Paul of some anxiety, he says there, right? Thus making room for more joy in him. Anxiety out, joy in. Epaphroditus shares joy. And then Paul also was sharing joy, what? By writing this letter, verse 19. I hope in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you soon so that I too may be cheered by news of you. So think about this. The Philippians, when the letter was sent to the Philippians, they would get joy, right? Be cheered in hearing from Paul when Timothy visited them. Yes, Timothy's here. So it's like Timothy comes with a card. It's not just a card with words. It's a card that you open up and it's like confetti and it's singing and it's yippee. That's what it'd be like for them. And then once Timothy had visited the Philippians and got back to Paul, told them, hey, the Philippians are doing great now. They've been cheered. They have joy. Then Paul is saying, I'll get joy. I will be cheered in hearing about them too. It's like this great, beautiful cycle of joy. Just keeps going. They get joy, we report back in the gospel. They get joy, we report back in the gospel. And again and again. Sharing joy required some type of presence. And that's not a T-S at the end. That's an E-N-C-E. Some sort of presence. For them at the time, that presence was physical. Right? There was an urgency you can hear in this, right? It wasn't enough for Paul to just share a letter at this time. He didn't like that enough. He says, I'm sending him to you. I want to send him to you. I want to come to you. A letter about Epaphroditus? Yeah, Epaphroditus, he's doing great. He's feeling better. That wasn't enough for Paul to share joy in this moment. He wanted some physical presence to bring elation to them. If it was the only option, sure, send a letter. Which is presence in its own way through communication. Sometimes communication is the only presence we have, as we can relate to right now. During others' hard times, don't try to be super. Just share joy. It doesn't get much simpler than this, but it does require a certain kind of attitude, doesn't it? And you're commanded toward it. It's difficult to share joy if you're not a joyful person. Receive him with all joy, Philippians. It's a command. And it will require some type of presence on your part. That could be physical presence. Some people probably right now just need you to show up and stand on their porch for a minute. For us right now, physical presence looks a little bit different. Our only option, your only option, depending on what kind of category you're in relation to this pandemic, it may just be non-physical ways that you can share joy. Might be a digital way. But you got to show up in people's lives somehow when they're hurting to share it, to share joy. Who these guys were, Paul, Timothy, Epaphroditus, who they were and what they did during others' difficult times, it wasn't heroic, but it was very much worthy of honor. That's the way we categorize it. It was worthy of honor. Verse 22. But you know Timothy's proven worth. How as a son with a father, he has served with me in the gospel, right? Proven worth or proven character. There's that part in the Hunger Games very early on, right, where the contestants come in and they have to prove their worth in front of all the people who are going to be sponsoring them or whatever it might be. And the main character, Katniss, right, she finally just puts an arrow through an apple in a pig's mouth or whatever it is, right? She's proving her worth. This is how it was for Timothy, just serving. Just serving the needs. And Paul says, wow, this stands out to you, doesn't it, Philippians? Whoa! Aaron! I'm now, Paul is saying, drawing attention to it myself because it's worthy of honor. He actually uses the word honor down in verse 29 about Epaphroditus, right? Look at it again. So receive Epaphroditus in the Lord with all joy, and honor such men, or we might say honor such people, probably, is how that should be translated. This is a very good and biblical and appropriate thing for us to do. Paul does it again in 1 Corinthians. He does it again in 1 Thessalonians. He'll do it in 1 Timothy. Honor, honor, honor. It's good. These things, sharing joy, serving needs, showing concern, they seem like very little things, and in many ways, physically, they really are. And yet, you can see that they're really huge from a spiritual perspective. Right? Think of how tiny a diamond is but think of how huge its proven worth is. Why are these things actually so spiritually massive? It's because who these guys were during this time and what these guys did for the Philippians and for each other was a demonstration of Christ's likeness in them. This connects this passage to the rest of the chapter, Christ's likeness. For it was Jesus who humbled himself to do all of these things. They weren't trying to be super because they knew the one super already. They didn't need to be Jesus to the hurting. They needed to show what Jesus is like. Jesus himself is Jesus to the hurting. When you're wondering what in the world to do for those sometimes, those someones in your life who are in difficult spots, like maybe they are right now, and you're wondering, what do I do? Let Jesus be their hero. Point people to him and his sacrifice for them. You don't have to be the fixer, the changer, the swooper-inner. He's got that. Rather, as you are being molded into his likeness, don't think heroic. Keep it simple. Show concern. Serve needs. Share joy. Let's pray. God, we do ask, Father, that we would be those who point people to our hero, Christ. God, we want him to be exalted as the worthy one. For he has conquered sin and death, and we never could. Doesn't matter what kind of super suit we think we can put on, we can't be that hero for anyone. Oh, but Jesus has. God, and as you mold us more and more into his likeness, may we serve in these simple things, pointing others to our Savior, Jesus Christ. Oh God, he is indeed so worthy. We may honor each other. We may show each other's character as proven. And yet, Christ is worthy of all honor. His character is unblemished, unstained. His work is proven. And it is sufficient to save us all. Thank you, God, for enabling your Son, Jesus Christ, to do that very thing. Fully God and fully man. He is worthy. We worship him now together. In his name, amen.
Conquer the grave. He's in.
Share it with others, pointing them to the worthy one. He is. In his name we pray. Amen. Thanks for being with us today, CBC. Thanks for hanging in there. For those of you who are able to get back on the feed, if you're still there, we will stick around here for a few minutes and hang out a little bit and do some trivia and just fellowship some. And if you'd like to stick around with us, we'd love to chat with you a little bit in the comments. So, thanks.
CBC. Everybody doing good?
You made it.
Yeah.
Thank you for a good cell service.
The feed went out, and then while you were preaching, the screen turned blue like that.
Nice.
So, hey, but it's good. It's all good. hope you guys are sticking around with us today, and hope everything's going well with you. I want to ask a couple of questions because you said some things during your sermon.
I try to say some things sometimes.
Yes, you did. Molly, were you listening?
Yeah.
Good, because I'm going to ask some questions. But first things first.
It's, you know, speaking of are you listening before you say your first thing, you know, when there's only, you know, like 10 of us in here, you're kind of stuck, like, listening. If you're not listening, it's like, it's a little obvious, you know. Not true. That it's not always, you know. We have the sleepers. I know who you are. It's fine. Sometimes you need it, but this is even more like stark. It's like, whoa, these people are accepting way more eye contact than they should have to, frankly.
But you know,
I commend them for it.
But it's okay. It really is. Let me make sure we get Molly here.
It is.
It is. It's good. Is Molly one of the sleepers? Are you a sleeper?
I've never fallen asleep in church. Ever.
That's amazing.
I don't know that I believe it. Anyway.
She definitely hasn't in this go-round.
Bible trivia.
Okay, first things first.
Matt, remember, I don't know if you guys remember who were here last week. Matt got all of them. This week he did not. So you can't answer because we've already done this.
Deal.
But that's okay. I respect you no less than I did last week.
Well, that's good because I kind of respect myself a little bit.
Okay. All right, beginner. Are you ready for this? By the way, I went to Sandra Revel's house today, this week. And I could just picture her because she's always on it with the Bible trivia. And I could picture her. She's got a beautiful view of a lake behind her house. And I could just picture her. I'm picturing her right now in that room with the big window. Ready. Ready. Sandra is ready. Beginner, from which country did Moses help the Israelites escape from their lives of slavery? From which country?
Country. Remember.
Yes. From which country did Moses help the Israelites escape from their lives of slavery? Does anybody have a guess on that? Where's your phone?
Camp has it. I didn't want to look down like I did last time.
Jessica answered Egypt.
Nice.
Egypt. Okay. Max, what about you?
I was going to say Egypt.
Christina Jones said Egypt.
Carolyn, yes.
Everyone's saying Egypt.
Yes. Christina.
Carolyn.
Egypt.
Katarina.
Max, Syria is wrong.
I didn't say so.
Yes, Egypt is correct. You can find that all over the place. You can find it. I mean, God says it over and over throughout all of Scripture.
It was a pretty big deal. But it's kind of like a paradigm setting kind of event.
I'm going to say Exodus 13:3 is where one of the places. But God does say it. Oh, he reminds them over and over. So it's very important that you know that, Egypt. But let's move it up on to intermediate. Intermediate. Who was Bathsheba's first husband? Who was Bathsheba's first husband?
I see a lot of hands out there.
Anybody know who Bathsheba's first husband is? Like, for example, Rebecca Pugh's first husband is Matt.
Carolyn Peterson said Uriah.
Boom.
Uriah. Uriah is.
Speaking of honorable
Kara,
people.
Grace.
Yeah.
Nailing it. Lots of Uriahs.
I can say that Uriah. Uriah. Yes.
Get enough of that at home.
2 Samuel 11:3, you can find that. Bonus points. Does anybody know who Bathsheba's second husband was? Bonus points, Max?
David.
David who?
The king.
David the king, yes. Correct. But that's not one of the questions. Yes, Uriah. Good one. But we're going to move it up now to difficult.
It's always a really big jump right here.
Well, I mean, intermediate difficult, it should be.
I'm not saying I don't like that.
Yeah. All right. You got this one earlier.
Did
this
I? Week.
Yes, you got this next one. Difficult. Who rolled up his cloak and struck the Jordan River with it, after which the river parted so he could pass on dry ground? Here's the thing. Someone took a cloak. Rolled it up. I can see. You know how you do.
Clark, what's a cloak?
A cloak is an outer garment that you wear waist up or knees up. You know, it doesn't go all the way down to your feet.
Sure.
So this guy took the cloak.
I always picture a cape.
A cape.
Grace,
I don't know why.
Grace said Elijah, question mark.
Ooh. Elijah, question mark.
Elijah?
I don't need. We're not going to accept question marks. I need you to commit.
Okay, someone...
Peg
Goldberg said Elijah.
Said what?
Elijah.
Elijah?
Yes.
Okay.
And Everett and Carolyn said Moses.
Okay.
Grace said Elisha.
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 Okay, Grace said Elijah, question mark, then change it to Elisha. And then someone
final
said.
Final answer?
Here's the thing. Elijah took his cloak, rolled it up, swatted the Jordan River with it, and the Jordan River parted. And Elijah went across on dry ground with his buddy Elisha. After that, Elijah goes up into heaven. After that, Elisha picks up the cloak that he dropped whenever he went up into heaven. Then Elisha rolled it up, bam, hit it. And Elisha did the same thing. So Elijah and Elisha are both acceptable.
Wow. That's nice.
Yes. You can find that entire story in 2 Kings 2, particularly 8 and 14. I don't know if they did it like that, but you know, that's what I think of when he says roll up his cloak.
I'm a little more methodical.
Oh, like rolling, like kneading dough?
I probably set it on the ground, you know, slowly get the rolling going.
You would.
Like a tight sleeping bag.
You would do that, but Elijah would not.
How do you know that?
Because.
You're right, he does seem a little reckless sometimes.
Yeah, and rightfully so. All right, but we're going to move it up to intermediate. I mean, we're going to move it up to you'll never get this. This is the one that you didn't get.
Didn't get it. Probably don't even remember it today.
You know who I think would probably get this one? Mark Hines.
Agreed. Don't even know what the question is. Doesn't matter.
You'll never get this, Molly. In whose house did David, second husband of Bathsheba, in whose house did David place the ark after Uzzah died? Remember Uzzah touched the ark because the oxen stumbled? Uzzah died because they were transporting the ark. After that, they took the ark and they placed it in somebody's house.
I'm just now getting Mark Hines
reference. In whose house did David place the ark after Uzzah died? Max.
Max is confident.
Brad.
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 About time that Brad made an appearance.
I think they drove past Brad's house.
With their cart.
I think he was unclean at the time.
Leprosy.
Yeah, yeah, we'll stick with that one. Huh?
No one's answering.
That's a tough one. That's a tough one.
What?
It's pretty delayed.
Yeah,
oh,
it's
we are
a delayed
behind.
Today.
I don't know how to read that, but here's Sanders' answer. Eliab?
No, that's a good guess.
Great
that is
guess.
Incorrect.
Peg yeah. Says Samuel.
Samuel is incorrect. Who
also,
said that?
Also a good
Peg.
Guess.
Peg, she also said Obed.
Ooh!
It's very close.
Seems like enough for me.
It's hyphenated. Let me put it that way. The correct answer is hyphenated. Who said Obed?
Peg Goldenberg.
Is that Grace's mom?
Grace's mom.
Yeah.
Yes.
Obed is close, Peg Goldenberg. Very close. I can't give it to her, though. Obed
agreed, but, I mean, at least give her some props.
Obed is...
Grace said my mom.
Grace's mom is where the ark
no,
was hit?
No, incorrect. Just kidding.
Yeah. Michelle Williams said Mark says thanks for the arm motions to Clark. Hello with exclamation.
Nathan Obed. Said over Edom.
Over Edom?
And then he said Obed Esom.
Okay, Nathan Longenecker is circling around it. It is Obed Edom is the correct answer. And I don't believe for a second that Nathan Longenecker knew that.
Come
I don't,
on.
No, I don't believe that. I simply don't believe it, and that's okay. The Sandra correct...
Said,
yes, what?
Sandra said it.
Sandra said Obed. I do believe that. I do believe Sandra said that.
That's a very hard question.
Yes, that's... Well, I mean, you'll never get this.
Good job, Peg. I give you partial credit.
Well, she said Obed.
Yeah, so... Uh-huh. So, they needed to house the ark, and I believe they did it for 3 months, if I'm not mistaken, at Obed-Edom's house. Just think about how... Just think about your reputation and the honor that you have to have in order for even to be considered to say, hey, let's take the ark. We could take it to Molly Butler's house. You think they would say that?
No,
I don't either.
I want like security guards.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
Like big people trying to steal.
You probably had a really good storm cellar.
Mm. Hmm. Obed Edom.
Nathan said stupid spell check.
Oh. Yeah, after you Googled it. Very
next
good.
Just copy and paste it from the Google search you do, Nathan.
Very good. I and great job, guys. You guys impress me every single week. I would not have remembered that last one for sure. I would have had to look it up. How was everybody's week? Does anybody want to share anything from your week? Anybody in CVC virtual land? Do you want to share something from your week? I do want to reference something that you said, Matt, in your sermon. You said, don't try to be super. And then you listed, I think, three things. Just be this or just share this. Mm-hmm. Don't try to be super. And I wanted to ask you guys in CBC Virtual Land, are any of you guys fixers? Like, is what Matt was saying, is that hard to do? Like, you want to be super. Like, you want to fix it. Like, who is a fixer? Like, when something happens and you see someone and your heart goes out to them, but you want to fix it. And you think you have failed if you can't fix it. Matt said, don't be super. So are any of you guys, so Matt, you raise your hand, you're a fixer. Christy Butler, raise her hand, she's a fixer. Who is a fixer? Rebecca Pugh, raise her hand. Tim Butler, raise a hand, he's a fixer.
Molly's raising her
hand. The whole Butler family is fixers.
Yeah.
What about you guys?
One technical term I used was a swooper inner.
Yeah, I heard that, swooper inner. For example, Matt said, don't try to be super, just show concern or just share joy. So
Ruth said Jody. Grace raised her hand. Jessica. Michelle Williams.
Okay, so for those of you who are raising your hand, who is, let me see. Jody, Jessica, Susu, Michelle. So is that difficult for you guys? To don't try to be super, just show concern. It made me think of a Derek Webb song, if I can say that.
You can.
God rest his soul.
With an asterisk.
Yes. Derek Webb of earlier years.
No endorsements.
No endorsements. Of earlier years. He was telling a song, Matt, you know the song, about being at a funeral. And he said, words aren't remembered, but presence is.
That's just a fact.
So that's an example of someone not trying to be super, but just showing concern. Is that difficult for any of these people on there?
They haven't said yet.
What about you, Molly?
They're still saying that they are.
You're saying you're a fixer.
Yes.
So let's say you have a friend who has issues. Things are going on in his or her life. Do you you want to fix it?
Yes.
And what if you can't?
Usually they remind me that.
Who's they? They can't see.
My parents.
Okay.
They have to remind me, you can't fix it. You just need to be there. And when I remember that I just need to be there, that's the best thing to do, then I can. But first instinct is just want to fix it.
Which is not a bad thing.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Yeah, good point.
Yes.
Who said that?
Hard to stay in.
Mm-hmm. Hard to stay in your lane, yeah. I'm not a fixer, but I'm a talker.
Yes.
Don't laugh. So I have to be intentional to listen and to shut up.
Good. Yeah. That's right.
Hey, why is my family laughing?
It's not just your family.
Look. Hey. I'm trying here.
Hey, we're all admitting things here.
That's right. So, don't try to be super. Just show concern, in whatever way. And someone might show concern in a different way. Tim probably comforts people differently than I do. Or Andrew probably comforts people differently than Bridget does. You know?
Yeah.
So, I thought that was good, Matt.
Thanks.
You know what else I thought? In fact, this next thing I thought was the best thing you said today. You said, don't be Jesus to someone. Jesus is Jesus.
Yeah.
I liked that. You know, we say these phrases. I just got to be Jesus to somebody. Just go be Jesus to them.
This is what Susu said. It takes a lot of pressure off of myself when I realize I can't fix things in people and it's not my job.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, it's a weight lifted for sure. I think we have burdened each other, I think, with undue guilt, often burdened ourselves with guilt because of the complex that we have where we feel like we need to be, the ones to fix something. Yeah. It'll get you. It'll eat you up.
God, I think, does the heavy lifting, right? We be there for somebody.
Yeah.
Grace said, I like how Bridget comforts with a little bread emoji.
Oh, Bridget comforting with bread. Birdie bread.
I thought about that when I was saying, don't, make sure that you find what people need, not what you want to give. And I was like, everybody needs bread.
Everybody.
I actually thought that. I was like, everybody needs bread.
Yeah, and everybody likes bread.
Good job, Bridget.
I'm going to tell you something. We did 4 deliveries yesterday, and my car, when I would go out and we would give them, and then we'd get back in the car. Smelled good.
Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, we have these little phrases that we make up, like be Jesus to someone. And I get the motive behind
that. Yeah,
you know.
Motive.
But also maybe we don't need to say it anymore. Or my prayers go out
We kind of overestimate ourselves when we say that.
Yeah.
We overestimate our abilities.
When I was thinking about the Hochstetler family, I was thinking people say, our prayers go out to you. And I understand the thought behind that, but our prayers go up to a sovereign God, right? Our prayers go up to God, you know, and then he does whatever he wants to with those. So, yeah, good. Don't be Jesus. Jesus is Jesus. And you can't do it, Molly. You can't be Jesus. So, all right. Well, when did the feed go out?
While you were praying.
During the prayer time? The prayer time, okay. And then when did it come back in?
Before the song.
Moments later.
Okay. I wanted to make sure. Yeah.
We had to end it and start it over.
You know, we sang Before the Throne of God Above. That was Katarina Chavez.
She said she liked the song.
Yeah. Well, she brought it to my attention earlier this week, and I had kind of forgotten about this song. And so
mind-boggling.
I know. It's a fantastic song. And I told her we would do it. I said we would not do the chorus, but we did the chorus, Katarina, because Clacy, Molly, Tim, and whoever the other one was. Christy. Sorry. Nailed it in practice. So I was like, we're doing the chorus, even though I told Katarina we're not. So, yeah, good. Thank you for that. All right, well, guys, I'm glad. I'm so glad that it was only for a short time that it went out. Thank you, Tim, for using your data plan instead of the Wi-Fi. Thank you, AT&T, for giving Tim a decent data plan.
Sprint.
Guys, enjoy your week. Don't try to be Jesus. Just share Jesus. Don't be super. Just show concern and just share needs and just share joy. And remember, Obed is a different person than Obed Edom. So it just simply doesn't count. Sorry. All right, guys.
Mike Wilson said it quit when Matt said people love fanny packs.
Oh. Mike Wilson said that when Matt said people love fanny packs. Fanny packs, look, it's one of those things, they're very unfashionable, but they're practical.
So practical.
They're very practical.
Golly.
Like those socks are not practical at all, but they're fashionable.
I can't wait to do something. I can't wait to do something that requires a fanny pack soon. I'm fired up now.
Tomorrow. Do it tomorrow. All right, guys. Thanks for joining us.
Bye.
See you next time.
Love you guys.